When did you decide you didn't just want to work in AI, you wanted to have your own company?
Well, I'll give you a serious answer and a funny answer. The funny answer is I started my career at Microsoft. I'd been there for 5 years. The plan was, you know, stay for 5 years. That's a big resume requirement, you know, minimum 5 years experience. I was waiting on my green card. But this was when, you know, Twitter, I think, was just presented at South by Southwest and took over, and the iPhone, the App Store, every day there was a new Instagram and Uber and all these apps. And I just thought it was so amazing that a small group of people with an idea could build a billion-dollar company. And that's why I moved here from Canada. We talked about California earlier, so I love the weather, the music, the culture, but I was following my American dream, definitely. Once I had worked as a product manager for 5-10 years, I thought that I was ready for it. I'd led teams of people. And then the funny answer is, once I started to get a bit tired of working at Microsoft and big tech, you know, you can only work on spreadsheet software for so long. I saw the movie The Social Network, and it is still to this day one of my favorite movies. And I know it's not necessarily the right message for how to do things, but it just seems so exciting and world-changing. And I think everybody wants to make an impact on the world. And for me, it was always going to be in AI. And then once I had worked at this Viv Labs startups with the Siri founder, I sort of saw how easy it can be if you have the right people, the right idea, and you don't give up on yourself. So yeah, that's what set me on the journey.
At what point did you get involved with Y Combinator?
Well, I had applied, and we didn't get into the batch program, but I think probably what you're referring to is they, during the pandemic, they put their startup school program online, and it was free for anyone to use. And again, that's what we hope our app could be, is resources that anyone can use. It's not just for the elite who get in and went to the right schools. Y Combinator is very hard to get in. We hope to get in someday. But when I was at my previous job, and it was the pandemic, and I had a lot of free time in the evenings and weekends, I took these Stanford AI product management courses, and you had to write a paper on AI, how it could disrupt an industry. So I wrote it with my brother. He's an assistant director on Toronto and Vancouver on TV shows and film sets. He worked on Suits and The Boys. Everybody seems to love those. And I wrote the paper with him, and the professor just said, A+, you gotta quit your job, go do this. I see the team product market fit. Wasn't quite ready. It's pretty terrifying to, I'd worked in tech for 15 years and there's a big safety net, but I finally felt like I had the right co-founder and my brother and the right idea. The time was right. Generative AI was just starting. So the last thing we did was we signed up for Y Combinator and took the course online. And during the course, you have to interview like 5 to 10 people a week. So my brother, we interviewed everyone on his set and people he'd worked on previous sets with. So writers, directors, producers, executive producers, stunt coordinators, costume makeup, everything. And we showed them the early prototype. This was well before the strikes and ChatGPT, so AI wasn't so controversial. And people, they would type in their idea, maybe a character, maybe, oh, this is how it should end. And okay, I'm always stuck on act two, how to connect act one to three, and it would give them an idea. And one person said, oh my God, it's perfect. It's like it read my mind. I'm jealous. Why did I not think of this idea? Can I use this? And that's when the light bulb went off. So we submitted that, the results, with Y Combinator, and they sort of agreed and encouraged us. So after everything looked good, quit my job and we went all in.
And I think you had said in a prior interview that at Y Combinator on the application, they ask like how long you've known your co-founder and different things like that.
Yeah, that's their biggest thing. And I investigated why. And also they don't allow one person to apply. You have to have a co-founder. And then one of the biggest reasons people fail is you've never worked with them or built anything with them. You know, you just met them online or something, and or you both went to Stanford. But yeah, I was able to put on my application. We have been working together for 30 years because when we were little kids, probably about eight years old, my dad got a VHS camcorder. And so we were obsessed with the movies Ninja Turtles and Ghostbusters. My mom always said, you don't even need a babysitter. We'd just put on the tape and we'd watch it over and over till it would burn up in the VCR. And then when we couldn't watch it, we realized we had the parts memorized. And so we would act them out and then we would film us doing it. And then that led into my brother and I making movies. So we've been making home movies to indie, you know, high school project to even movies today. I'm an executive producer on his latest. So it was fun to be able to say that. There's been ups and downs. And the other thing they say why you need a co-founder is one of you will be up when the other's down, and it probably won't be at the same time, so you need to pick each other up, and you want someone who's not going to quit on you. So I think with my brother, you know, we used to beat each other up. We got all that out of our system when we were kids, and now we're able to just believe and trust in each other, and I think that was a strong point on the application for sure.
Yeah, that's fascinating. I love that. You had talked about that in another interview, how when one is up, the other one might be down. Mm-hmm. And that's very crucial.
Startups are hard. 95% of them fail. And I liken it to, my brother says, you know, Hollywood's history is people will move from Iowa to LA and just, you know, they have the film courage and they will just give it everything and give everyone their screenplay to read and but it's hard. Probably a lot of actors fail, probably a lot of screenwriters fail, and maybe just they didn't have enough money to keep going in LA and they had to move back, or there's many reasons I've heard, and I think that people don't end up breaking into Hollywood, and that's really what our company's mission is to help more people around the world who have stories to tell, but they don't have the connections and the money. They can't move to LA. They didn't go to a film school like USC. So how can we help them learn what they didn't in film school? And so our app is, it's not just a generate a script and you know, you have nothing to do with it. It's really almost a teaching tool and a writing buddy to help you where you're stuck and maybe where you don't know character arcs. So maybe we can help teach you that. And give ideas. So yeah,
sure. You have a video, I think, about Legally Blonde. Yes. If L were to become president, and different prompts and motivations, and
yeah,
it was enjoyable to watch.
That's my brother's girlfriend, and she helps us as well. She used to be a voice actor and wanted to break into Hollywood, never made it. Ended up, you know, moving back home, and she's a waitress now, and going to be a mom soon, and she's happy. But yeah, I think she still has the itch. She wishes, I want to get into, you know, voice acting and filmmaking. And so Legally Blonde's her favorite movie. And she said she, for years, she's always wanted to just see Elle as the president. And so, for example, she typed in a premise, clicked generate, expanded to a log line. And then she said, okay, give me a title. And the first title it gave was Commander in Chic. Instead of Commander in Chief, and that's when she said, okay, I think this works. I think you have something here. And she said, you know, but the AI made it, so is it mine? Can I copyright it? And that's an important point. Everything our users make in our app, they own 100%. We encrypt things on our end, so our employees can't read your work. And we've studied copyright law. Maybe we'll get into this later, but if you put enough human work and effort into something, if AI helps you, it's still yours and copyrightable. So yeah, she loves it. She can't make a movie with Legally Blonde IP, but it was just, yeah, an exciting proof point, I think, for us.
So because Legally Blonde is not in the public domain, is that
part of it? Yeah, I mean, her dream would be to contact Reese and get it made. But yeah, it's just not hers. It's more like a fun fan fiction, just